So hello everyone, and welcome to our Green Tech Investment Forum. We're glad to have you all with us, and we're going to take a couple of minutes to let everyone join the call. And in the meantime, I invite you to start using the chat function to exchange and to share your contact details to start the virtual networking. So that we can wait for everyone to join in, all presenters and all the participants. And then, of course, we'll start just in a few minutes. I'm also sharing now in the chat the link to the folder with executive summaries and presentations of the companies that you're going to meet this evening. So if you haven't done so yet, please go on the link and check it out. You can get to know better the companies that are going to be presenting that you're going to see just in a couple of minutes. So use this link and refer to this link in case you have any questions or you want to get the contact details of the presenting companies, or you're just curious to learn a little bit more. We're going to be using the chat function a lot in today's forum. This is where we're going to exchange contact details, but also ask questions to the presenting companies. So take a look around, get comfortable with it. And of course, feel free to share your contact details so everyone can get to know you better and can get the idea of who's in the call today. I think we have a pretty international audience. So it's going to be interesting to exchange the context, and maybe while you do so, say where you are from in the world. It's going to be very interesting to see. So, Karsten, should we begin slowly with the introductions? I think you're on mute.
Yeah, I was muted. Sorry about that. Yeah, sure. I think, Olga, we're good to go. If you can see that we are about 100 plus, I guess, participants now.
Yes, correct. So I think maybe more people will join us in the next few minutes, but I think it's a good point to start. So let me begin. And once again, welcome everyone to the Green Tech Investment Forum. We're thrilled to have you with us this evening or this afternoon, depending on where you are in the world. Myself, I'm based in France. So it is about 7 p.m. here. So glad to see everyone who's over in Europe. So my name is Olga. I'm the CEO and co-founder of the Startup Club. We are, as you might know, an international entrepreneur community, and our goal is to help startups across the world in their fundraising, development, and growth journeys through events such as this one. We organize pitching events across the world and across many different industry sectors, and we're really excited to have this event in partnership with Company Capital and also with Starlight Capital in the US. The later company in particular deserves a special recognition. We've been working really closely for the past year with Brian Emerson from Starlight Capital on making this vision happen and bringing the investor networking conferences in this
green
online and virtual
pitching event to investors.
And in this virtual world in particular. So it's been really a great journey together with Brian on making this happen. Starlight Capital has been organizing investor networking conferences in the US for over 20 years now. So we're really thrilled to take this experience and to be able to bring this in this online world in especially difficult time now of the pandemic. So if you have more questions to Brian, I think he shared his contact details in the chat. So feel free to connect with him. He's going to be happy to answer your questions. And now I would like to pass the word to Carsten from Company Capital, with whom we're really excited to present this second edition of the Green Tech Forum. So Carsten, your words. I think I put you on mute again, sorry.
I'll try again, sorry about that. I forgot about the unmute. So hello everyone and welcome. Thanks Olga for the introduction. We are very excited about having so many people joining us today and six presenting companies. And like Olga said, this has been something that has been worked on heavily over the last months. It will be a continuous event. And Brian in the US as well with Starlight Capital has done a great work in setting up also companies for this event. Our company is based in Copenhagen in Scandinavia, and what we try to do is help generate the inflow of potential companies that will present at these events, primarily within green tech, within med tech, and within security tech focused companies at various levels. So they would come from either a Danish market, a Swedish or a Finnish market, but the Nordic, the northern part of Europe is what we focus on. We've been doing so for the last 12 years in two combined companies and have raised about 145 million US for a number of companies over these years. And we are thrilled and excited about having Olga as our workmate. Olga has done a huge job in setting up and organizing all of this. And with Brian in the States, this is a great event that we look very much forward to getting on with over the next years. So that would be my introduction to our company, and I can see some of the faces I've met there previously. So hello to Peter, Gladys, and Alice. Great to see you again.
Yes, great, really great to see some familiar faces and many people returning again to our conference. So we're really, really excited about that. Just a quick note for those who are joining us for the first time today, I'm going to remind you how the conference is going to take place. So we have four presenting companies and two featured entrepreneur guests tonight. Each presenting companies will have a video presentation played. And after that, we'll have about 10 to 15 minutes of Q&A in live with the founders. So all of you can, during the presentation, prepare your questions and ask them in the chat. We're going to use the chat, as I said previously, a lot for this Q&A in order to keep it neat and simple. So please prepare your questions and write them in the chat, and then the companies will answer them right after their presentations. And also, feel free to stay until the end, because we're going to have some informal networking, and we encourage you to stay until the end to get to know each other a little bit better after the presentation. So I think I can pass it back to you, Carsten, for the first presenter.
Yeah, sure. Great. This is an exciting company, I think. I used to be in the automotive industry, so I'm looking forward to Hank Venter presenting Bison EV, a rising new supply of electric retrofitted vehicles by battery or hydrogen driven motors. So the video will turn up right now. So please enjoy.
Good day to my fellow investors. I'm Hank Venter, founder and owner and CEO of Bison EV. Bison is a vehicle retrofit company that does the following. A, we extract the internal combustion engine from vehicles and we pull it out, substitute it with either electric motors always, and then the power drive is either battery operated or hydrogen operated. We want to have affordable vehicles in the market for the rideshare industry. It'll be existing vehicles that's already safe and crash tested, nothing new. And we want to supply a broad spectrum of the market. We do have an international footprint. Bison will be based, headquartered out of America, where we hope to ultimately start with 12,000 vehicles a year, up to 100,000 ultimately. We have legs in South Africa, the UK, where we have a bus deal, and some other strategic alliances that's in the pipeline. We really have a top management team, very seasoned auto executives, like for instance, Ian Thompson, who is the co-developer with Elon Musk. He developed Lotus, or represented Lotus when Elon developed his Tesla Roadster, and they built the first 1,000+ vehicles together to get Elon on his way to bring Tesla back to America and redo it here from the UK. Then we have people like Chris Reitz, who's the grandson of Ferdinand Porsche. I don't have to say anything more. We have people like Kuba Spence out of South Africa, who is a top designer and developer and patent holder on certain stuff. And so the battery side will be very good, and we will buy always top of the range batteries off the shelf and just put our own proprietary control box powertrain in with GPS monitored capabilities. On our hydrogen, our leadership is even stronger. We have Brendan Norman, who's established Audi and Volkswagen and some other major car companies in Asia. We have people like to manufacture my hydrogen, Dr. Gerard Human, who's already built a container with chillers and everything inside to fabricate the hydrogen. And then we have Herman Marais, who's already worked with container companies where we can do the vessels, where to store it in or to transport it in. And we definitely want to bring that infrastructure to the market as quick as we can. As you know, the electric vehicle industry is huge, currently only 1.7 million, and within a couple of years, we're going to go to $54 million as represented here. We only 2.8% of all vehicle markets as EV, and within 2040, it's going to be 58% EV vehicles. Our technology will be, we have proprietary in-house, but the major stuff, your batteries, your drivetrain, your will be all developed, bought off the shelf, but our control boxes, the GPSs is proprietary, and therefore we can control these cars wherever they go. We basically take out the ICE internal combustion engine, the exhaust system, and the fuel tank, and we replace it then with either batteries, control box, powertrain, and GPSs, or in the case of hydrogen fuel cells, with the hydrogen fuel cell control boxes, containers, and tanks. Our mileages will be around about 250 miles plus on the electric vehicles, with still a couple of hours charging, depending on what battery manufacturer product we use. On the hydrogen, we will go 500 plus miles up to 1,000 for the big trucks and containers. And of course, as you know, filling time will be literally a couple of minutes. So we will develop both, carry on with both, and make money out of both sides. We will concentrate on the private sector, mainly like the rideshare, Uber and these people. They have 4.2 million drivers. If we do 100,000 a year, it will take us 42 years to supply that market. So it's a huge market. And but we'll concentrate on fleets, corporate fleets, and governmental / state or federal fleets that we will convert and that has it. So it's all based on contract, and we will sell direct to them into the market. Our strategic arrangements suppliers will be always with state-of-the-art OEMs, and we will buy always state-of-the-art technology from time to time as we use Ford, and you will not be stick with one system. In South Africa, we're going to do the buses. We start off with about 560 buses from a specific group, and it'll go to a couple of thousand. We do tuk-tuks for the Indian market and some Asian markets. It'll be great for there. In the UK, we're going to do some taxis, start off with about 9,000, go up to over 41,000, and then airport buses, and so that will convert there. So And in America, we're going to start off with a big site here, 60 acres with a 600,000 square foot building on, and we'll represent from there going forward to do first 12,000 vehicles up to 100,000 vehicles per year. But we're looking at other states also for establishing down there, depending on grants and incentives we'll get. Then opportunities under consideration, various different ones from the aviation industry to whatever. Future technologies will stay on top out of South Africa, the CSIR, universities, top of the range people, hydrogen, the same thing. It's such a fast evolving industry that we're not going to link ourselves to one specific supplier or so, but we will always want to do state of the art top things going forward. Our financial contribution will be profitable from year one. Gross revenue could be several billion in year 4 or 5 going forward, and EBITDAs will be 100 million plus in that same stage. Looking forward to hear from you for a transaction proposal, your interest. I'm available for any questions, and please contact me at hank@meowsgroup.com or to contact me directly at my phone number, +1-404-804-0084. Bye.
Well, excellent, Hank. Thank you for a great presentation. I invite you now to connect, to turn on your camera and your microphone, and to say hello to everyone while we are looking at some questions that are coming in at the chat.
Thank you very much. My camera is on and I'm on the speakerphone. So any questions, I'm more than happy to try and answer.
Well, perfect. Thank you. We have a first question here. So hydrogen and electric are very different markets and approaches, especially in the passenger and vehicle space and in trucking. With the advice in general being to focus on kind of one minimal viable product, to what complexity, how are you handling this diverse space and those two different products?
With the easier one is the battery one. There's much better infrastructure available, and we will also supply charging stations as and where needed, but that market's already becoming junior matured all over the world. The hydrogen is the more complex one, and therefore we'll just concentrate there more on the heavier trucks, or like concrete trucks or buses that always come back to the same depot at night. And that'll be easy then to have just one manufacturing and redispensing station on site. That's how we're going to start the market. And as the market matures and the more dispensing refilling sites becomes available along major highways and so, the hydrogen, we believe, is going to ultimately be the product that's going to take over. And needless to say, we're going to stay with green hydrogen, meaning all our charging and manufacturing stations will have wind power or solar power on top. And only in worst cases, when none of those two are available, we'll top it up with normal electricity.
Well, thank you. Thank you for answering. We have another question from the chat. You mentioned the South African buses. Are you modifying them from diesel to electric or to hydrogen? And also, can you discuss financials of the project and just in general, yes, financials of the project?
Thank you. In South Africa, they started off initially, the clients were interested to go to battery. But as you know, the Achilles heels of batteries are short distances and very long charging times. So the client has decided that the latest thing trend is to go hydrogen. So then we're going to go straight into hydrogen and do the conversion. So we're making use of a joint venture partner we have out of Australia that's already done 1,300 plus buses in China, convert them from diesel direct to hydrogen successfully. And we're going to piggyback on their knowledge and so on. That's why some of their top people is on my executive teams as well. And that's the way we're going to handle it. Cost in South Africa, initially the biggest cost would be for the first five. We have to do a charging station and so, and that's the very, very expensive cost, the manufacturing / dispensing site. But we will bring the cost down of those vehicles from because we don't have the original vehicle to buy. It's just like doing what I call a heart transplant. Take out the diesel engine, do the hydrogen plus the tanks, and we should get the costs well below $100,000. So that helps the client to maintain their capital investments where it is. They don't have to start rebuying new vehicles, and we should get those costs down to somewhere lower than $70,000 eventually. But ask me in a year's time, and I'll tell you where we got it down. Currently, the budget is around about $100,000 per vehicle to convert.
Excellent. Thank you. So another two questions here in the chat. Could you tell us about the technology readiness level of your invention? And could you also talk about the competitors in the market?
Yeah, technology is in-house. We first also tried to develop our own vanadium-based batteries. We stopped that because you can get so much better performing and newer technology in the battery industry off the shelf. So currently we're going to buy all our batteries basically off the shelves from various competitors. And as you know, the battery industry compares a lot like with laptops. Every quarter, there's a newer one that's faster, that's smaller, that's lighter, that's better and costs even less. So therefore we're out of the battery manufacturing development side. We're just going to buy off the shelf there. Our internal IP will stay as the control box and the drivetrain conversions. That's in-house proprietary that my guys there develop, and one guy here in America currently. So, and going forward, we hope to do the hydrogen basically the same, buy the fuel cells from the top manufacturers, have some strategic alliance with them, and extend into the market that way. But
thank
our
so
GPS
much.
System mm-hmm. and our control box and so, and drivetrain conversions, that stays IP in-house for the group.
Mm-hmm. Got it. Thank you so much. So the next question I'm seeing is about your expansion plans. Do you plan to go into South America as well, or could you maybe talk to us about your expansion plans in the future?
For the next 6 months, all depends on capital. For the next six months, we would like to establish specifically now, of course, the UK and the Americas, which is a huge market first. But there's nothing stopping us if we have enough capital to cookie cut it and expand into Latin America or to Asia for that matter. Mm-hmm. So we are open for that. I just don't want to grow too fast because that's just as dangerous as not to grow at all. But everything gets timing-wise determined by capital available.
Mm-hmm. Of course. Could you also talk to us about how the pandemic affected your industry or, you know, your company in particular?
Yeah, very, very, very sadly. We were busy in London last year in January, converting the first couple of taxis of a very large city. And we were about halfway through and people came to us and tell us, hey, do you want to hibernate and be in quarantine here for 6 weeks or so? Take the chance and whatnot. Lucky enough, we made the right decision. Some guys went back to South Africa, one to Australia. I came to America and we are a year later and we can't put a foot there. All our stuff, our spandrels, some of our clothes are still lying for a year and we're going for 1 month now, still in London, in the UK. So yeah, it was a bad effect. Timing-wise, it pushed me out at least a year, but at least we carried on in South Africa and we started retrofitting the first vehicles in America. And I've done the first couple of years and we've done quite a lot down in South Africa.
Well, great, thank you. You've been able to react quickly to this. So a couple of other questions that I pick up from the chat. So how plug and play is your system? Does one-off conversion make sense financially, or do you need to be doing large numbers of the same vehicle for this to be a viable option?
The latter one. We're not going to do everything mm-hmm. off the street for everybody. We're going to pre-select several models. Like just to give you an example, our Jeep Chrysler Jeep Cherokee that we have in here that we start doing in America is a perfect conversion. Then I pulled in a Ford Escape front drive and we're having problems. We just don't have enough space for the engine to fit in once you pull out the exhaust system and the transmission. So that'll be a more difficult one. But the major drive of our decision for vehicles would be what goes in the rideshare market. Our Uber drivers or our Lyft drivers will tell us they prefer these couple of cars in an executive format, and we will convert them but we will pick six or eight of those that's easier in brackets, retrofitted and convertible, and we'll stick to them.
Got it. Thank you. Another question I'm seeing is about the location that you have in America. Maybe you can tell us a little bit more about that.
We're looking at various locations. The one I prefer, because I live very close to it, is just outside Asheville in North Carolina. And it's a 660,000 square foot facility, plus got 66 acres. So I'll have more than enough space to park at any given stage a couple of thousand cars on site. Because if you start doing 100,000 cars, just to think about it, it's more or less 8,000 a month. So you'll have about 12,000 cars. You know, you've got your 8,000 that you're going to retrofit, 2,000 that's been retrofitted, plus another 2,000 new ones coming in. So at any given time, you'll have like 12,000 vehicles at least on site. So we need some acreage there as well. It's right onto a major highway, I-40, although we're not going to cater for what we think the public market. We're going to do deals with large corporate fleets that has this green mentality, and they have their cars, they'd like them to retrofit them, or we buy it from them 2 years old. Same with Avis or Alamo Car Rental or Enterprise Car Rental, buy those cars, retrofit them and sell them back into a mass market, like to the Uber driver, the Lyft driver, the rideshare market. So we're going to concentrate on that first before we're going to go for the general public. But if Joe Blow arrives there with a lot of green bucks, we can always talk.
Well, excellent. I think maybe one of the last questions coming from my side, actually, could you tell us a little bit more about the capital that you're seeking and maybe your vision for this capital that you're raising now?
Yeah, normally a big business like this, if you start talking about $1 billion of revenue, you're talking about billions of capital. That's the nice thing about us. We'll start off with the first raise around about $12 million. There's going to be several tranches over this 3 to 5 year period, and we don't see it go over 120 million. Thereafter, we'll be totally self-sufficient, can grow internally and go on from there and give them away, of course, as little as possible additional equity. But I'm looking for a strategic investor, equity player, strategic partners that can take us to other levels as well. It's a phenomenal business to get involved because we're not going to put in a big production line or so. It's all just hoists. Like, you know, you go when you do your oil changes, those couple of hoists, you hoist the cars up, you take out the engine, put the rest in there. And on average, it should take us ultimately 3 days to do a car. But initially, of course, you're going to start 2 weeks, 3 weeks as you do the first one and the second one lesser and lesser. But we hope that pretty soon we'll be on an average of 3 to, let's say maximum 5 days for a car. It comes in on a Monday, Friday, it should be out ready for the customer. Mm-hmm.
And could you maybe talk about the challenges that you face in re-registering the vehicles, for example, from diesel to hydrogen?
Of course, if you walk in there, that's very easy with the registration department. First of all, they say, what? They don't know. But once they know, you only have done a heart transplant. Everything, safety features, crash test features, stays exactly the same, done by the big companies, Ford, Toyota, Hyundai, Honda. And no problem since then, but the first expression on their faces are pretty interesting. But no problem so far.
Well, that sounds great. Sounds you have this under control.
We don't do anything structurally. We only do it, like internally, just like, as I say, a heart plant for a human being. Mm-hmm. You know, just take out that and put in the drivetrain. So, but we are very cognizant of the weight distribution, especially when it gets to the batteries. Mm-hmm. And more so when it gets to the hydrogen, the big fuel cells. But lucky that normally goes on big trucks. There's always a lot of space for those tanks behind the cab. And worst case, you can put it on top of the bus or in the carriage space, because the buses we're going to convert is not so much passenger buses. It's more things like just in a city or at a airport. You know, those people don't have luggage all on their back. So you've got a lot of space at the bottom to do it.
Okay, got it. I think the last question that I'm picking up, which I think is quite interesting, what do you do with the old engines that you take from the cars and with the materials?
Initially, it's very easy. You just sell it off to a normal scrapyard dealer, but ultimately we'll do strategic deals into, call it third world or lesser developed countries, where these engines will come in still pretty brand new and we'll sell it and we recover that cost. Ultimately, we might just have to scrap everything for metals. but we foresee for at least for a couple of first years in each country, we will be able to extract it and send it to closely underdeveloped countries that would love to buy those engines very affordable.
Got it. Well, thank you so much for answering all the questions and for being with us today. I think that you might have some more questions popping in the chat, so feel free to reply to those. And of course, if anyone wants to connect with Hank, you can ask him for the contact details or reach out to me, and I'll be happy to introduce you for further follow-ups. Thank you so much, Hank.
Thank you, Hank. Great presentation. And I guess anyone, like Olga said, reach out to Hank and get his material and phone number and get any additional information from Hank directly.
Thank you very much, everybody. I really appreciate it and looking forward to any of your questions. Hank@bisonminerals.com or my telephone number. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thanks, Hank. So, Olga, is it time to turn to the next presenting company?
Yes, correct.
So SMS 360 is a leading provider of environmental health, safety and compliance, integrated risk management technology. This is very complicated for me to say, so I had to read it. It is presented by Jonathan Wheeler, and we'll turn to the video first.
Hello, I'm Christian Ducker, the founder and CEO of Safety Management Systems and our brand SMS 360, a subscription-based software platform comprising modules covering health, safety, and regulatory compliance for all types and size of business. Effectively, a safety net for business. Over the course of our careers, the SMS team members, each with feet on the ground experience in various aspects of health and safety, came together with one common goal: to make it easier and more cost effective to save people's lives. Safety is invisible until something goes wrong, and then it is very visible and very expensive, costing US companies alone in excess of $170 billion a year. It can also ruin their reputation because you can't put a price on a person's life, and over 5,500 Americans lose their lives every year at work. Regulations do not discriminate. Whether you have 50 or 50,000 employees, you are governed by the same regulations. And the solution is SMS 360. The majority of competitive systems on the market are expensive, so expensive that 78% of all US companies do not have an electronic safety and compliance system. So it's not surprising that 76% of fines land on the SMEs. Our dream is now a reality. We built a system that is modular, mobile, affordable, and multilingual to support the multicultural makeup of the at-risk workforce. Our clients benefit from reduction in costs caused by incidents, and predictive analytics helps keep workers safe by pinpointing unsafe and high-risk areas and by improving operational efficiency. Every business has competition, and safety and compliance software is no exception. Early legacy platforms are expensive to replace and higher priced overall, and it's difficult for those software vendors to pivot to compete in the SME market. However, the biggest competitor is paper. In today's digital age, we are still clinging to the security blanket of paper, but that is changing as regulators introduce electronic reporting, including fines for untimely submission. SMS 360 is built with new technology to be scalable as a vertical market to give efficiency to our smaller clients and enterprise systems for the larger ones. Our clients range from 50 to 5,000 employees and include waste, trucking and construction, a port terminal group operating in 9 countries and 7 languages, and a global tire manufacturer. January 2016, we were a team of 3, no clients, no systems. That was our goal for 2020, and COVID visited. Our clients put on the brakes, all trade shows cancelled, so we took advantage of the time, increased mobile capability, and planned our next level of growth, and that led us here, in spite of COVID. We will finish the year with a 20% increase in revenue and carry a healthy recurring subscription base of $1 million into 2021. And the future looks even brighter. Based on our market analysis, our total potential market in the US represents approximately 31 million businesses. Of those 31 million, 807,000 represent businesses with 50 plus employees, our focus market. Conservatively, if we were to penetrate 0.1% of those 807,000 businesses, we estimate revenues would equal 1.6 million monthly or close to 20 million annually. We have taken a cautious approach to our projections for the next 3 years. We have done this because we recognize that we will not achieve 100% share on day one. The team shares in my confidence that we can accomplish these projections and growth. Thank you for listening. I would be happy to answer any of your questions.
Well, a great presentation now on behalf of the SMS 360 team. So I would like to invite Christian and or John to join us now for the Q&A part.
I think we seem to be having a little bit of connection problems over here. So can you hear me?
No worries. Yes, I can hear you fine and I can see you fine. So perfect. Thanks for being with us and thank you for your great presentation. So while we're waiting for more questions in the chat, let me start. And maybe, first of all, you can tell us a little bit more about how you're planning to approach that 800, I'll say, target clients that you have identified in the market.
Well, we have our marketing area, as I said, was a lot. We've been able to build a scalable system. So within our vertical markets right now, which have expanded a little bit into energy because of a new client coming on board, the bigger clients are generating the information for the smaller contractors. So I don't know globally. I mean, we have a very big client in out of Amsterdam who are, and again, it's all about the contractor level to push out. So we're finding now that we are being recognized. We're only 5 years old. But that's pushing us out into these vertical markets of construction. We're doing something out of Brazil, which is all based on contractors. So it gives you the bigger clients who paved the way and the smaller contracting base as well, who have to show a safety record today to get big clients. So it's been a interesting journey.
Understood. Thank you. So we have our first questions from the chat. Could you please talk about the revenues to date and maybe the track record? I think you showed in the presentation a little graph, but maybe you can cover it again a little bit more. Maybe also include the feedback from the clients that you received so far.
Yeah, I mean our background, as I said, was out of the EHS and environmental software side. So our growth was really 2016, we got clients with no system, which was interesting. So, but just two. So we've gradually grown now to in excess of 20. We have, our model has not changed, but it has expanded in the fact that we were approached to give a presentation and on a services side for trucking, and we won it. And that client is not SMS, it is FedEx Ground.
So that has then pushed us now into a growth of, we finished out 2020 actually 33% above what we started in after 2019. And that revenue was $1.25 million. So in that 4-year period, we had gone up onto that. We had projected to double it. Of course, like everybody, we actually did well in 2020. Despite everything, we were able to very quickly recognize, and I suppose it helps when you come from England because they seem to get it before everybody else. We were able to kind of move and do other things and grow in our mobile side of the system.
Mm-hmm. Okay, got it. Very exciting. Well, congratulations. Another question I see. Could you please talk a bit about your capital raise requirements and the planned use of resources moving forward for the near future?
Yeah, we are right now actively seeking investment. In any various forms, really, of $2.5 million. What that will do is it will give us, we're already a little bit ahead. In fact, I think we're a lot ahead of some of our competition who I know. And that will give us that extra solid runway into move. It'll be predominantly in the technical side. We are expanding out of what we do for FedEx Ground. We are expanding that out as well, which is more services. And that that investment will help us push that even further. Staff, mainly marketing. Our hands have been pretty well tied with we put everything into the tech side. And so now we're ready to really kind of go forward with that, with the investment.
Well, great. Thank you. Would like to remind everyone to ask the questions in the chat if they have any to Christian. From my side, maybe you can talk a little bit more about the competition and the competitive landscape, and if you see any other technologies emerging that are doing something similar or the risk of it.
Well, we have competition. We have big competition, obviously, and those competitors focus on the very big clients, very big companies, and are far more expansive than we are in some ways. But there's no real challenge that we see into the small company area. I understand why. I jumped off the corporate cliff in 2015 having massive clients. But I think now what's happening is that the, as I said in the presentation, regulations are changing. And we are seeing that. And I think the smaller companies, if you get them as we are, affordably for them, they're not high maintenance either, which is a good thing with those clients. But we're also splitting off into municipalities, again, with the vertical market approach, especially here, and it's not just going to be here, we're in South America now, and we're in Europe. It's now just taking that and building up those teams to push it out there.
Got it. Well, thank you. Another question that I'm picking up, will UPS's divestiture of UPS Ground impact your firm?
No. In fact, I think you're going to find what we're finding, because we have a dedicated fleet team. We classify accidents, so we know how many accidents are on the road. I think a lot of people in the industry were surprised about the divestiture of that by UPS, but I think on another thing, it will just increase. It'll increase the business. A lot of carriers don't want to recognize. They're in a catch-22. A contractor, you've got to be very careful legally with a contractor, whether you give them, tell them what to do, then they become classified as an employee. And so I think you're going to find far more contractors out there and people, unlike the UPS, you know, they've got so much. Pandemic has been wonderful for them. It's also put a lot of small businesses out and small trucking companies out of business. But I think you're going to see a shift on that in 2020, 2021.
Got it. Thank you. We have another question here about, let's say, marketing and approaching customers. So as a lot of cyber security and compliance companies are focused on Fortune Global 1000, your focus on the small and medium businesses is extremely important. But given the huge number of such businesses, how will you access and sell to them? Maybe you can go over it once again.
Yeah, I think that, well, we are definitely, it's going to be self-service. So the one thing about the smaller companies is they're not as complex in, they want something simple. We have tested, this is absolute fact. They want to, they have to be compliant. It has to be simple entry, which is why we're looking at all our mobile apps, obviously, but also from a voice to text. So you've got to come in at a low price, and you've got to do mass marketing, not as heavy duty as you would with a big company. It's got to be. You know, we have a great young marketing team, and so that's how we intend to go at it. But it will be self-service, so it's not like a salesman has to be involved, or you know, you'll do trade shows and things, but that's the way to reach them.
Okay, got it. Thank you. Well, one important question for me is maybe you can talk a little bit about your team and who you have on the team that makes the project successful.
We have a great fleet team. They come out of, like if anybody knows, in the American area, XPO, Conway Freight. So we have a great fleet team who do that side, and they're all... mostly ex-truckers, so it's not like they've come in academic and said, okay, we know all of the DOT regulations. They're definitely feet on the ground. We have some great, you know, people, our, you know, CFO, also, you know, COO are experienced. We're all a little bit, you know, we've all got a bit of a few age on us. But we've now started to bring in, that's the experience. And now we've started to bring in the younger crew. As it was pointed out to me the other day when one of them picked up his phone and said, I was born with this. So he said, and that is the next generation of where we're, of our system. So we've got the age generations, but it's all working positively.
Well, that's great. That's a very good mix.
Yeah, it is. It's a lot of fun, actually, when you get a mixture of people who have the same common goal. And yeah, it's should be a soap opera sometimes. It really should. Maybe make more money with it. I don't know.
Exactly. Well, Karsten, do you have any final questions to Christian?
No, I thought it was a very nice presentation, and all the answers that you gave to the questions also, Christine. So thanks so much for that. And anybody who wants to reach out to you, I guess the presentations will be available, including the contact information, etc.
Thank you.
Yes, thank you so much. So I think, Karsten, now would be the time for me to introduce our two featured entrepreneur guests. So we'll take a quick...
I think that makes sense. That.
All right. So we have two companies with us today who are not presenting, but who would like to share with you what they're doing and maybe to connect and network. So first of all, we have Fluid Power with us, which converts ambient heat in the air into electricity. It is a very interesting technology that has really an exciting range of applications. So if you would like to learn about Fluid Power, you can visit their website, fluidpower.com, or you can contact Ben Schwartz. So you have his contact details here. I will also share the slide with you afterwards, but I also invite Ben to share his contact details, email, LinkedIn in the chat. So anyone who's interested can learn more about you. And also, Fluid Power's presentation is included in the link that I shared in the beginning of today's forum. So please check it out and learn more about Fluid Power Systems. And the second company that we have with us today is Cascadia Carbon, who are disrupting the voluntary carbon offset market by tokenizing carbon offsets for environmentally conscious individuals and enterprises. It's a very ambitious project, and Cascadia Carbon are located in Oregon, but are operating internationally and have very strong ties, not only with local community, but also in the green tech ecosystem worldwide. So if you'd like to learn more, once again, you can visit their website, cascadiacarbon.com, or you can check out their executive summary in the link that I sent. And last but not least, Alex, I invite you to share your contact details with us in the chat. Or, of course, you can reach out to Alex by his email that I have listed here. I'll share the slides with you in just a second in the chat. But please do check out more information on Fluid Powers and Cascadia Carbon. So this is it for me for the featured entrepreneur guest.
Yeah, so they were two great companies as well. So the presentations or the links have also been shared.
Mm-hmm. Yes, correct.
Good. So should we turn to the next presenting company, Olga?
Mm-hmm. Yes, that's the time.
So the nanolucent technologies is presented by Anthony Humble. It's an AI-based rapid cancer diagnostics company. So the video will show up now.
Welcome to Nanolucent Technologies, holographic imaging to AI-powered cancer diagnostics. Here's an overview of our presentation. Our business and technology advantages consist of transformative digital AI-powered cancer diagnostics, innovative technology with an impenetrable IP fence consisting of more than 50 patents, and a clear path to multi-billion dollar profits and valuation. We will be profitable and self-funding by the end of 2023, primarily due to net margins that are greater than 70%. Crucially, we bring cloud access to global markets, enabling rapid deployments around the world. And to achieve this, we require $20 million and offer a 3-year convertible note with a 5% coupon. Our key applications and markets are as follows. Our critical first target is the existing cervical cancer screening market, which is slow, expensive, and prone to manual errors today. We expect FDA approvals and commercial launch by mid-2023, and we will be going after the instantly addressable US market of 50 million tests annually. We'll roll out globally through local partners to an addressable market of 770 million tests annually, with the potential to increase it. We will then pursue many future applications using the same device, including lung and throat cancer, and eventually the massive virus screening market. Bringing cervical cancer screening into the 21st century. The problem is that existing cytology-based screening programs are labor-intensive and subjective. According to the American Cancer Society, quote, one of the limitations of the Pap test is that the results need to be examined by the human eye, so an accurate analysis of the hundreds of thousands of cells in each sample is not always possible, because some abnormalities may be missed. The nanolucent solution is based on an existing and tested prototype. It leverages secure cloud AI for accurate automated image processing and identification of abnormal cells. It provides results within 30 minutes. It is cost-effective, portable, and simple to operate, enabling every healthcare office and practice to benefit. Most importantly, it is accessible to all women around the globe. The nanolucent solution is a truly global one. We refer to it as the hub-and-spoke health model. The market size is greater than 700 million tests annually, considering one test every 3 years for every woman between the ages of 21 and 65. There's no physical shipment of samples, so local labs are no longer required, except as input points to our cloud-based system. So our 3D holographic images are sent to the cloud, where our AI-supported deep learning algorithms separate positive from negative results and report them back instantly. We have international reach. Rapid implementation across the developed world is highly achievable due to our hub-and-spoke decentralized capture model. On the other hand, women in developing countries are very vulnerable to cervical cancer. However, Nanolucent is committed to providing solutions even to those in remote regions. We believe this improved access will result in many thousands of lives being saved. We see a clear path to profits. Barriers to entry are crucial to any first-to-market technology such as Nanolucent's. Our protective barriers are rock solid, as we have exclusive rights to the key technology from our partner Lucendi Inc., which we will use to develop our own proprietary IP. Our IP patent fence consists of more than 50 patents that protect every aspect of the technology. The future promises large, growing, protected profits and multiple new market opportunities. Our next diagnostic targets are lung and throat cancers, enabling while-you-wait screening, and in vitro virus screening, utilizing proprietary photosensitizers within 4 to 5 years. In summary, our strategic direction is to focus on the cervical cancer screening market in the US and Canada by Q4 2023, in Europe by Q3 2024, in China and the rest of Asia by 2026, and in South America, Middle East, and Africa over the period 2027 to 2030. We are targeting lung cancer screening for 2024 and throat cancer screening for 2025. Finally, we plan to launch our broad-spectrum virus screening over the period 2025 and 2026. To execute this strategy, we need to raise $20 million in a Series A funding by the end of Q1 2021. Our partner Lucendi will act as our technology team during development and will transfer know-how to Nanolucent prior to product launch. Nanolucent will hire a science team and regulatory consultant in 2021, a contract research organization in 2022 to recruit OBGYNs and other practices, and a marketing group also in 2022 to promote our system. And we will launch our cervical cancer screening system in July 2023. The Nanolucent team greatly appreciates your having taken the time to hear the story of our incredible technology breakthrough, which we believe will deliver a great upside to our investors while bringing accessible, worry-free cervical cancer screening to women around the world. Thank you.
Well, Tony, thank you for a great presentation. Please join us for the Q&A.
Okay. I'm here.
Hi. I think your camera is a little blurry.
There it is.
Okay, how's perfect. Okay. Yes, there you go. There you go. Okay. Well, thank you for joining us. Thank you for the presentation. So while we are waiting for more questions to come in, through the chat, maybe you can start off by telling us a little bit more about your partner, Lucendi.
Lucendi is quite an extraordinary company, actually. We were very fortunate to find them about a year ago. We were coming from the therapeutic side. And it turned out that that Lucendi had developed this amazing platform, which basically converts the entire process of sending away pap smears and waiting two weeks to 8 weeks for a result, and essentially converts it into an instant while you wait service, and which we realized very quickly was something that could be reproduced globally, as we say on our hub and spoke model, which is really the we believe the future of screening, not just cancer screening but virus screening. Where everything is collected at a million points around the world, and basically forwarded to the cloud system, which gives an instant diagnostic. So while you wait, so we said, okay, this is really special. This will also facilitate the future of therapeutics because of the immediate response. And so we basically for the last year we've been working on setting up a deal with Lucendi. They've been working at this for 12 years at the OSCAN research group in UCLA, and they have an incredible IP fence that obviously not only for human applications, which is our deal with Lucendi, but also for many other applications. everything from water analysis to 3D holographic projection, you know, working with car makers and so on. So we were fortunate enough to be able to negotiate with Lucendi the human biology rights to this incredible platform.
Well, thank you. That's very exciting. Great news. Congratulations. Mm-hmm. So maybe you can talk a little bit more about your distribution and your sales channel and how will actually this product reach the market.
Yeah, absolutely. Well, this obviously is a business-to-business application, and I have a lot of experience in that area. And we will be, because it's such a dramatic, transformative change in the marketplace for screening, we've decided that we're going to very early on start building an order book with the entire, we're starting with North America, of course, but we know word's going to get out and it's going to be, you know, spread very quickly to Europe and Asia. But initially we plan to build an order book amongst the physicians, OBGYNs, and the walk-in labs around North America. So frankly, with so many thousands of data points, collection points, we do expect to have a large order book by the time we launch in July 2023. Now, having said that, as the word gets out, obviously, we're going to be approached by, and we will be targeting certain other countries. We've actually, since we presented at this forum 2 months ago, we're well into a discussion with a Chinese-based group who want to be our distributors over there, for, you know, basically China, Russia, and so on. But we're focusing on China it's a massive market there. Not just because mm-hmm. there's a lot of people there for, you know, a lot of women for cervical cancer screening, but it's a massive problem with lung cancer in China. So we will be probably spending the next couple of months working on the deal with these partners. We're already, as I say, working on the deal, but that will give rise to many other deals with regional distributors. We believe that we'll have a number of distributors in Europe, a number of distributors in the Middle East, and so on, and Southeast Asia. But our goal is to do regional manufacturing and have those regional representatives do whatever deals they can do, particularly in the way of support from local governments and so on for manufacturing and distribution. And again, getting a million devices out there for this massive sort of decentralized mm-hmm. Collection and centralized processing system that will, in the future, provide, you know, we're talking almost a billion cervical cancer screening tests a year, but probably there will be an equal number of lung cancer screening tests in the future. Many others, and of course, I'm not even going to go to the COVID, question. But obviously, there's going to be a massive demand for instant screening for many different types of virus. I don't think we've seen the end of this of the current pandemic. Obviously, with all the variants coming forth, we will be able to do that instantly. But as I say, one thing at a time. We're focusing on the most important, the key application for us is cervical cancer screening, and we will take that mm-hmm. to the market in 2.5 years.
Got it. Thank you. Mm-hmm. Could you also talk about the environmental implications of your approach of diagnosing cancer compared to the BAU approach?
Okay. So sorry, I didn't quite catch the acronym there. Which approach?
BAU.
BAU. What's that?
And business as usual. Okay, oh. There you go. We're getting an answer.
That didn't get to Canada yet. I'm sorry.
Picking it up from the chat.
Well, environmental is actually not a direct environmental, green environmental link per se, but mm-hmm. obviously there are many benefits to having direct input at the point of collection, as opposed to distribution through through fleets of couriers and so on. That's not really that much of a benefit. But now I might throw the floor over to Maxime, my partner at Lucendi, to see if they've come up with any environmental benefits of their technology. I know not cervical cancer screening, but they are doing a lot of things in the environmental area that complements what we're doing. Maxime, would you like to jump in and address that question?
Sure. So we in parallel are currently working on applications of our technology to various other markets. One of them is for identification of micro objects in liquids. Tony did mention that we're looking at water analysis, water quality analysis, but some of the other applications include identification of and characterization of algae, both for identifying toxic algae as well as characterizing those algae that are being farmed for various useful quantities. And our technology can essentially help in all of those markets. And what makes it unique for all these applications is that it's based on holographic microscopy married to AI, which effectively allows us to build our systems very cost effectively in comparison with conventional microscopic systems, and at the same time achieve performance that far surpasses existing solutions. So effectively you can think about applying this to any domain where microscopy is needed, but on a much more cost-effective level that you otherwise could. So obviously that opens up many applications in environmental and green field as well. But here with Tony, we're talking specifically about cancer applications, of course. Yeah, thank you.
Mm-hmm. Thanks, Maxine.
Got it. Well, thank you so much. Another question that I have from the chat, I guess it will be to you, Tony. Why don't you start with the COVID screening, as this seems more pressing with the funding that you have available now?
Well, that's kind of an ironic question, because the one of the parent companies, which is Photosonics Canada, did actually start with COVID. It's actually a COVID therapeutic. But of course, it's I guess what you can call a red ocean market already by March, what we'd already been discussing, what was another pandemic of sorts, which is I guess you can just call it an epidemic rather than a pandemic of cervical cancer. Yes, it's true that COVID is a massive global problem. But, we couldn't even get close as a small company in Canada. We couldn't even get close to that market. However, with a completely new platform such as Lucendi's and an epidemic problem in continents like Africa, we have 100,000 deaths a year, a 50% plus fatality rate. Horrible problems, and they're basically related to accessibility. I know it's going to be the same problems with COVID vaccines, but so we decided to go for something that I don't really like to characterize as a blue ocean market, because it's not really a blue ocean. It's a horrendous problem, but it's a very socially responsible way of getting into a marketplace that will eventually expand upon the use of our platform.
Thank you. Thank you for answering all the questions that we had. Carsten, okay. Do you have anything to add or to ask?
No, it was a good run through. And finally, the final question was relevant, I think, because within the COVID space at the moment. So thanks for answering all the questions.
Okay. You're very welcome. Thank you.
So the next presenting company will be Tom. And I ask you, Olga, is the video, would that be available?
Yes, I'm actually going to ask Tom to share his screen and share the video, as it was a little bit last moment in terms of the editing details. Yeah, so. Tom, would you like to share your screen?
Okay, we make an aesthetic, high finish, affordable solar tile for solar roofing, for solar roofs. I'm the founder of the company. We have a disruptive technology in solar roofing with, and also includes a solar battery for 24/7 power. We are currently based in Toulouse, France, and we also have an office in California. So the problems and opportunities, only 1.9% of France's energy is solar power. And in the next 10 years, there's going to be a total of around 27 nuclear reactors that have to be removed. They're way past their age. And they decided to turn it into wind and solar. And 50% of the product will be solar. 91% of the French favor auto consumption. The alternatives are 28 cents for solar roads, or and all the way down to your own solar roof. So it's a solar roof, not modules on the roof. On the lower left corner of your screen is modules on the roof. And over there on the upper side is another demonstration of modules on the roof. Our project and product is solar roofing tiles. And you can see there's a fine terracotta outline of each of the tiles. They are highly efficient, affordable, inefficient. They have very easy installation, no racking plugs, no monolithic glass panels, steel frames. Parts are cut in half. It's all pre-assembled in a factory. The long-term investment benefits are 18 to 20% range. By the way, I want to point out that they've done an analysis of installing solar, and they've shown that 65% of the cost, it has to do with the installation. It is not manufacturing the product. So the getting the product installed is the key component for reducing the price. As you see right here, we create all this economic activity in the community. We redistribute 34,000 to each of our customers. That's a really good market driver. The product is disruptive, no junction box, 25-year guarantee. Okay, go back. Here is a satellite picture on the left-hand side, the same satellite picture, but only different products. Modules on the roof, the same kind that are in the utility field, and versus solar roofing tiles on the left side. At the top, you can see 9.6 kilowatts for this array versus 5.7 kilowatts for this array. Next thing I want to talk about is our battery. We believe we had the holy grail in solar roofing with combining with our battery. The battery is using lithium metal, has five times the energy density of, for example, the Tesla solar tiles or any other battery companies, 25-year life. This part right here on the right-hand side is the yellow part that all gets pumped back back to the utility. And the utility then resells the same energy back to you at three to four times higher. So the solution is just get it your own solar battery, and then you're completely can offset the grid. Here we are on competitiveness. We're comparing Tesla with SunPower, Emirates, and you can see that look on the bottom line, total per watt, $1.99 with a possibility of getting down to $1.24 versus $5.75 right now. The Tesla solar tile is only 10.7%. other comparisons are we have less degradation because we're using heterojunction cells than our competitors. Timelines, we're in between M7 and M6, M7 and M8. We're ready to launch. We need certification of our product. It's a total of 146 required to launch. 6 million for the startup phase and additional 140 million. That can be broken down into debt and equity. The European Commission would gladly match a 70 million equity investment, as well as the U.S. Department of Energy. They both have somewhat similar programs. What's in it for the investor? As you can see, you get a 30% manufacturing investment tax credit in France and Germany, and 100% finance for our customers, both in the US and in France and in Germany. It's a $1 billion market potential. We're first started in France, Germany, then going to Georgia and Texas. There's a total in California. Total of 500 million homes per year just in France, in Europe. This makes energy almost free. The current status quo cannot exist. We have a huge acute climate crisis. We have to take bold investment decisions. How much worse can it get? Right now, if you look at the left-hand side of this chart, we're way up here. We're supposed to be down where the blue area is. We have to change the way we think. This is our team, myself, the founder, the holder of the patents. Jim Smith is our chief operating officer. He has 35 years of experience in electronics and electrical engineering. The last 10 years, he worked for a company that installed automation robots. Our facility in France and Germany will be totally automated, totally. It'll be a level 4.0 automation. Down here, I have several PhDs working for us. We're red hot planet. And this is my name and my email. If anyone wishes information, you contact me at tom@soltiles.fr. Sure, it's a risk, it's a bet, but we think this is a winning item. Anyway, thank you. We'd be happy to answer your questions now.
Well, Tom, thank you so much. Thanks, Tom. For the presentation. Yeah, and for the great overview. I'm sorry we had to face some technical issues, but I think we got there at the end. So I already have some questions coming in the chat. So I'm going to pick them up one by one. So the first one is about manufacturing. Are you producing and deploying your own tiles? How are they produced and are where they're produced and are they mass produced? So maybe can tell us more about the manufacturing.
No, as I said, we're in the certification stage. It's really illegal to install your tiles on a customer's roof and before they have product certification. Our tiles, our prototypes, were all assembled in Germany and in a laboratory. It's very expensive to manufacture it there. We will continue, and we have an intermediate stage before we go that, and that'll all be done. We'll be manufacturing 4,200 tiles in the next stage for the certification stage. Next question.
Thank you. So are you building your own roofing tiles and also your own battery storage system?
We are building the cells. We're manufacturing the cells because they're heterojunction tandems. It's just not possible to buy them on the free market. It's the latest and greatest technology. The batteries are made by a company called X Energy, and they have five times the energy density of the current things on the market. Anyway, we're not going to be totally vertically integrated to make our own batteries. We're vertically integrated enough making our own cells and turning that into solar roofing tiles. That's where we end.
Got it. Thank you. Can you talk to us a little bit more about your track record and how much revenue do you have currently?
We don't have any revenue right now. As I showed you, we're in the scale up stage. We're a pre-revenue company. We're funded by grants and small equity investments.
Got it. Thank you. The next question I'm picking up, would the product also work on flat roofs with no slope?
It's got to have our product is designed for sloped roofs. Mm-hmm. Any sloped roofs, any.
Got it. The next question, what are your systems in the certification processes in Europe and the US? What is the stage of certification for the battery and storage?
Well, we have to go in France. We have to go through CSTV and as well as TÜV. And in Germany, it's TÜV, IEC. These are all the certifications. The tiles will. We've already developed. A special formula. Our tiles use polymers, and we had a tremendous amount of development problems. We solved those problems, and we have working prototypes.
Okay, got it. Thank you. Has the technology been combined with the wind generators and have the capacity to be combined with those?
No, this is we're not. I have no. This product is just pure solar. It's not designed to be solar. I mean, wind combined with it. It's just only.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. Got it. Next question that we have is about your tests and prototypes that you're in so far. So how many homes or buildings have you put your prototypes on for testing, and how long have they been there? Can you tell us a little bit more about the prototype testing?
Well, as you recall, I asked for 6 million. And let's go back to that. The 6 million, I believe, was for here, right here. ICBO, IEC, TV, 6 million is all for this, for more engineering. The 6 million up here for the next stage. And as I say, the factory will will just be loaded with robots. there'll be very, very minimal hand movement for the product. It's all robots. But this is, these are all the certifications that we need up here at the top, on the top line under capital equipment. And we'll be the 4,200 tiles, that's included in the demonstration phase.
Got it. And well, the finances aside, what is the timeline for you to pass the certification process and get the product to the market? How long do you think it will take you, and when can the product reach the market?
12 to 15 months. Mm-hmm. But on the 12th month, we'll have a great handle, and on the 12th month, we'll commence raising funds. I don't anticipate it'll take longer. As I said, TUV has already reviewed the electrical plugs that we use, and they've given us the green light. It was an unofficial green light, but we essentially we were going to do this, and we essentially ran out of funds, couldn't complete this particular stage because we didn't have funding. So anyway, next question.
So I think the next maybe one or two questions. So first of all, why is energy density important for stationary battery, and what are the most important factors to the consumers?
Well, the high energy density made with lithium metal is extremely important for the customers. You don't have the risk of fire. With lithium iron ion batteries, you have risk of fire. The energy density, you want it as high as energy density as possible, so you can store more solar in your battery. So you can use it to charge your car. If you can imagine, if you have two batteries there and they're 3,000 installed price, 3,500 each, and you have them installed, then you can essentially charge your car overnight with a full charge. That is sweet. So you can run your house and you charge your car. It's just just off your roof. And you could take trips up 300 mile trips and or 400 miles or whatever, and then come back. You know, this is a good system for energy as we switch off of fossil fuels.
Got it. Thank you. And maybe a last question before we can wrap up the Q&A. Have you also looked at potential pilot operation for commercial or administrative buildings, not just homes?
Building facades that could be used on. For example, at the front face of the building is in the northern hemisphere is facing south. That building would be a prime candidate for putting our tiles on. So, but for all homes, that's 100% winter. And in certain instances, yes, we can go on a commercial building, but on the southern facing side. Next question.
Got it. Well, thank you so much. I think that wraps up our Q&A, but if there are more questions to Tom, please feel free to write him personally. And of course, we'll be happy to connect you with Tom and with the team if you have any more questions or you want to chat. So thank you so much for your participation, and thank you for a great presentation today.
Well, thank you. I'm sorry, Tom. We had this... I'm sorry we had a technical issue. I thought we solved it.
No worries. Thank you. So Carsten, I'm going to pass the word back to you maybe. So for some remarks to conclude from your side.
No, that's fine. Thanks again, Tom. And hopefully the technical issues will not happen with the tiles once you get the production up and running.
Well,
thanks all for the presentations and the good questions and answers from the presenting companies. Everybody who stayed tuned until this hour. So we hope to see you soon again. I think maybe Olga, you have a date for the upcoming event. I'm not sure, but if you have, maybe we should announce. So thank you all for joining and hope to see you again. Reach out to Olga, myself, whoever can make anything worth your while. We'll certainly make a point of getting back to you very quickly. So thanks everyone.
Yes, thank you, Carsten. Well, first of all, and importantly, thank you for co-hosting this forum with me and for working with us hard on making this forum possible. I think we had a really great turnout today and great companies presenting. I was really happy to see a lot of interaction in the chat, exchanging a lot of context. So I think that was really pleasant to see. And thank you so much, Carsten, as well, for helping us make it happen. From my side, of course, thank you all for attending. I just shared in the chat a link to our upcoming event. In particular, Starlight Capital is organizing a technology investment conference in March. So I invite you all to check it out and click on the link. And the Startup Club, of course, hosts a number of early stage for pitching events for early stage startups. So you're also invited to check them out as well. We have an EdTech pitch night coming up, a food tech pitch night, a marketing investment conference, and many more. So please check out both websites for more events like this one. And otherwise, of course, feel free to write to me if you have any questions and if you'd like to get any more information. So thank you all. I think that this concludes the official part of today, but I think we're going to stay on the call for just a little bit to exchange maybe some ideas and thoughts. So if anyone wants to share anything and stay a little bit for networking informally, then please do so.